Hi everyone, it's Plastic EP here from Melbourne, Australia. And I got some fantastic people with me here, authors from South Australia, so they're neighbours. I've got Olivia Savas Koopmans, and I've got her dad, Michael X. Savas. How are you guys?
Hi. Good. How good, Plastic. How are you?
Are we feeling
good.
Groovy?
Very good. Feeling really groovy.
That's it.
Good to be here.
Hey, bananas, we think you're groovy.
We think you're groovy.
Hey, bananas, we watch a movie.
Watch a movie.
Yeah. Driving June buggies everywhere. Just going crazy without a care. Hey, bananas,
we think you're groovy.
Hey, bananas, we think you're groovy. Love to watch it cause your favorite show.
Hey bananas, we think you're groovy.
Hey bananas.
Hey bananas, we think you're groovy.
Not only do we think we're groovy, but look, it's like I got Plastic EP clones. I love it. Thanks for making a big effort. But we also got a brand new fantastic. This book is fantastic, everyone. It's called One Dream Ago. And you know what? It's all about the Beatles in South Australia. So I want you guys to tell me all about this fantastic book. It's got a kangaroo. It's got the Beatles in the pouches. And what's around his neck of the kangaroo? What's the two photos, the necklace? Tell me.
Well, that's a medallion. And it's got our little faces in the medallion. And Klaus Voormann obviously did Revolver covers and the anthology covers. He did the artwork for the cover, and it was his idea to have a kangaroo and have Ringo kind of outside the kangaroo and everyone else in the pouch, and it was kind of crazy, but yeah, it's cool image.
Well, I just got to say, if you got Klaus Voormann to do this, this is a world-class book just from the cover. So all the Beatle groups are going to be amazed by this. And I've actually seen all the photos inside. You can't believe the book the way it is quality. The photos inside the book are quality. It's just a really great Australian quality book. You should both be proud. And Olivia, I believe you helped Dad write it when you were 14 years old. What did it feel like being an author at 14?
It was pretty cool. I think the best part for me, though, was just going around with Dad and getting stories together. And we travelled around to get some stories, went to Europe together. And I think for me it was more exciting to be involved with Dad doing that. So a really cool experience as a 14-year-old.
I know, Michael, you're so proud of your daughter, and I would be too. Someone to help me do a book. I have trouble enough getting my sons to help me around the house.
Well,
Olivia has never helped me around the house. But okay. She helped me with the book and she did a great job. But for me, it was good as well because, you know, it's like, well, this is what I do. I love books. I love the Beatles. I like writing books, creating books. So, you know, I wasn't going to take her out fishing or whatever. I like fishing now, but not at the time. So, you know, it's like, this is what I do. And I wanted her to share that. So it was fantastic to do it with her.
Now, we know in South Australia, right, that there was 300,000 people turned up to see the Beatles, the largest amount of people in the world. And this is why this book is riveting reading. So now I want you to go and tell me basically about what happened when they came here and what you sort of, you know, the kind of research you did and what you discovered that not a lot of people may know. So I'll let you both discuss it between yourselves to the world.
Well, I mean, basically, the Beatles were coming to Australia and they weren't going to come to Adelaide. But Bob Francis, the big Bob Francis, you probably know, the colourful DJ, he got people signing petitions and people were signing on toilet rolls their autographs and sending them in, and they got probably tens of thousands of signatures to get the Beatles to come to Adelaide. So eventually they did. And then they came from the airport. They went along Anzac Highway to Town Hall. And all of Anzac Highway from Glenelg right to the city was lined with people. And it was 300,000 people. There's a bit of competition sometimes between Melbourne and Adelaide, as you know, and Melbourne people say they have the biggest crowd. Well, Melbourne might have had 300,000. We had 300,001 person.
We had 100,000.
We had the biggest.
We had less than 100,000. I know that for a fact because we had Russell Street.
Yeah.
You had Russell Street where the Southern Cross was, and you had also Lonsdale Street down there. And what happens is people were in the trees, and the five Beatles came out on the balcony. But what a lot of people don't know is when that was actually televised live on TV, they were more concerned about the glass breaking at the front of the Southern Cross Hotel because there was real glass, and if the whole glass had shattered, people would have been killed. So they were really concerned about the glass breaking at the entrance of the foyer of the hotel. You know, I'll let you continue. 300,000 people is unbelievable.
Yeah. It was absolutely crazy. And John Lennon said this was better than New York, really. It was the biggest reception they ever had. And there are quite a few things in the book that people mightn't be aware of. We discovered new information and got original photos. One of the things that's interesting, one of the people who was lining Anzac Highway was Jim Keys from Master's Apprentices, obviously. And he said, George, and he doesn't know why he said George, because George wasn't his favourite. George ignored him. John looked at him, and he made some kind of connection with John. And then years later, he was recording at Abbey Road while John Lennon was there. And he went into the urinal at Abbey Road, Jim Keys, and John walked in. And he just kind of stopped what he was doing and looked up and was speechless. And anyway, so I interviewed him about this for the book at Victor Harbour at a cafe there. And I said, oh, look, Jim, is it okay if we recreate that scene at the urinal? So he looked a bit strange. It's like, what does this guy want from me? But we went to the urinal, and he was a good sport. And there's a photo of him at the urinal looking shocked at John Lennon, and he recreated that whole scene.
I wasn't invited to that interview.
His face is like this.
That's right.
How amazing is that? That you get him to do things, and then that photo, tell me, Paul McCartney's in, is it a Volvo car? It's not an E.H. Holden. Is he in a Volvo car? That photo that's taken in the suburbs.
It's something like that, just something really ordinary.
I think it's a Volvo. I looked at the body. Right. I think it's a Volvo.
He went to McLaren Vale. You might know this really well-known wine region in South Australia. And he stayed there with Linda. This is in the mid-70s. And he actually wrote a song there at this place in McLaren Vale. And one of the guys who's in the book, he has gave us a lot of photos as well, and he was interviewed, Mark Baker. And he's like the Forrest Gump of Beatles. He's like, anywhere there was some famous Beatles happening, Mark was there, sometimes to the point where the Beatles were a bit kind of worried about this guy and asked security to turn it down a bit. But he actually found Paul and Linda at this house in McLaren Vale and just knocked on the door and said, oh, look, hi, I'm here. I'm Mark, I'm here. Late at night. And Paul McCartney said, I know you're here, but we just want to be left in peace. But, it's unbelievable. No security, as you say. He's driving around in this Volvo or whatever it was. Like, you can't go anywhere near the guy now, but this is what it was like then, mid-70s.
But those photos there, I've never seen those photos. I've never seen any of those photos in the book.
No.
It's unique. That's your unique and the information. Yes, I've seen the breakup. You even go into detail telling who the DJs were, different DJs on the radio. Yeah, right. See how big it was for the DJs back then. There wasn't internet. It was all word of mouth.
Absolutely. They had the power to make and break acts, as you know. Yeah, right.
And what about when they played live? That must have been like What research did you find out about that?
Well, I mean, lots of the people who went to those shows mid-June at Centennial Hall, they said they couldn't hear anything. You know, the usual kind of story about the Beatles concerts, they could just hear the screams. And there are only like 3,000 people in Centennial Hall. But Livia and I were actually lucky enough to go to a recreation of the concert by a Beatles cover band, and she would have been, how old were you then, Olivia?
I was 8. That was 2004, and they knocked down the hall a couple of months after. So it was amazing to go and do it before they knocked it down. I probably didn't realise at the time, but now I realise how significant that was. So
we really had a feel for what the
historical places like that.
It's terrible, really. Yeah.
Now tell me more about the book and what you discovered that no one knows.
Well, what did we discover? I mean, one thing is there was so many different things, but I've got a bottle here. And I know it looks dodgy holding up an empty bottle, but I swear I didn't drink it just before the interview. But why this is interesting, and this will hopefully answer your question, this is a memento from a meeting I had at the Hilton Hotel with someone called Beauvais. And it's a Wolf Blass bottle of wine. Beauvais signed it. And people, when we were interviewing people for the book, we heard about this son that George Harrison had who was in Adelaide, and people were saying, well, I don't want to say too much and whatever. So he was just like this mysterious figure. And eventually we were persistent. We managed to track this guy down, and he eventually came to Adelaide. He was living in England, and his name's Beauvais, and he's a musician. And he claims to be George Harrison's son, who and this guy Beauvais was living in Adelaide for quite a while. Anyway, so he was telling me the story about being George Harrison's son, and we shared a bottle of Wolf Blass wine. So his story's in there as well. Why Wolf Blass? Because Wolf Blass went to a dinner that winemakers in the Barossa Valley held for George Harrison. George Harrison used to come to Adelaide in the late 80s, early 90s for the Grand Prix. And this dinner was all in honour of George Harrison. And George Harrison sits next to Wolf Blass, who's a really nice guy, by the way. But he sits next to Wolf Blass. And Wolf says to George Harrison, "So, what do you do with yourself?" And he didn't know who George was. And George, being really humble, said, I'm in a band, and I used to be in a band and play guitar. And then Wolf says, "Wow, that's amazing. I play drums." So anyway, there's a Wolf Blass Beauvais story. So we found out about that. What else did we find out?
And that's how Wolf Blass became the fifth Beatle.
That's right, exactly.
He's one of the best winemakers.
He is.
A person that's good to know, obviously. George liked wine.
Yeah, yeah.
So he's absolutely in good company there.
That's right. Another thing we found out was that George played the Beatles song Free as a Bird in 95 to the public for the first time in Adelaide at the Hilton Hotel. And he used to stay at the Hilton Hotel when he came to Adelaide. So he played that there at the hotel at Margot's nightclub, which was a big thing in the 90s. What else did we discover? There also, Frank Pangello is a journalist and Adelaide journalist, and he interviewed George Harrison at the Hilton and had a really good chat to him. But he said that at the end of the interview, George says, "Got to go. I'm visiting my relatives in the hills, in the Adelaide Hills." So what does that mean? Who are George's relatives in the hills? You know, like,
this is riveting. That, this is cool. This is all new to me. Like, this is all coming out. What a fantastic, riveting interview this is.
Yeah, yeah. And to me, I mean, I, you know, you won't be able to shut me up because I just love talking about this stuff. But someone also, this woman that we spoke to, elderly woman, she said that the Beatles actually went to a church. Three of them went to a church in Glen Osmond, St. Paul's Parish, when they were here. So we're not sure if that's right or not, but that hadn't been said before as well. So, yeah, quite a few things came out, actually.
Isn't it amazing where you live, you find things out?
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
I mean, I don't know if you know, right, but I'm a big Monkees fan, right? The thing is, with 64, the Beatles came in, I'm 6 years old. So, I mean, what do I know? I'm just watching TV, screaming a noise. Then it's 1967. Well, I'm 8 9 years old. And the Monkees come on TV here in Australia in July of 1967, black and white, of course. So what happens is I'm hooked on the Monkees. So it doesn't matter what is your group when you grow up. Like, for example, my sister's ABBA. She's still ABBA. She starts off at ABBA, but everyone ends up at the Beatles. That's how it is in life.
True.
Would you say that's the same with you, Olivia? Who did you grow up with?
Unfortunately, I grew up with the Beatles as well. I didn't get much say in that. But now that you've mentioned ABBA, I'm probably more of an ABBA fan, having made my own choices now in music. But, all the music that I grew up with was from an era much before me, so really loved the Beatles growing up. I really loved the Doors as a teenager. Loved the Rolling Stones. Definitely didn't listen to a lot of music from my own kind of the same things as my friends or anything like that. But
see, my sister, I brainwashed it on the Monkees. I brainwashed it.
Well, same here, and I think with the Beatles as a base, it kind of got, actually all my daughters have got twin girls as well. They're all in. They're all into that retro kind of music as well as modern music. And we all went to the Monkees concert as well when they came to Adelaide a couple of years ago. And that was fantastic. I love the Monkees too.
You know what? As I said to you, it's who you grow up with, but I can't help it. That's my generation. Like this song, For Pete's Sake, in this generation, that's my generation. I mean, I went to school and I'm singing Monkees songs, right? I've got to like tell you where it is to zone in 67. So I'm walking to school and I'm singing Last Train to Clarksville, I'm Not Your Stepping Stone, Valerie, and then we get up to the song Going Down. I don't know if you've heard Going Down by the Monkees.
It's kind of psychedelic one, isn't it?
No, it's actually pre-rap. It's actually like a pre-rap song before rap in 67. It goes, floating down the river with such a liver. And anyway, I'm only 8 years old. It's very hard to know the words. So I taught myself the words. And now my age, I can't remember all the words, right? But that was like a task. It was more important to learn the words to Going Down than going to school at that time. I remember.
I'm on the weekend.
The real tongue twister.
No, and then what happens is, let me tell you, I'm in the schoolyard and I hear a radio and they're playing For the First Time I Was in War, I Am the Walrus. And it's like I'm hearing music from Mars. Yeah. Now we're talking 1967, we're not talking now. And I'm hearing Yellow Madagascar, Oop Oop Joop, whatever. I'm going, what is this rubbish? What is this rubbish?
I Am the Walrus.
Because it wasn't a normal song. It was like abnormal. And you know the story behind that song, don't you? At John's old school, the English teacher did lectures and started looking into John's words for his songs and had him as classes. So John thought, okay, if he's doing that, let's give him one that's going to be really hard. So he came up with that one that's like weird.
Try and analyze this one.
That's it. Thank you.
It's fun, and people still did analyze it.
You know, let's get back to Adelaide because I'm still fascinated. There's still a bit to go in the book. Just tell me, Olivia, you tell me a little bit about the book that you helped. What part did you help with?
I went along to a lot of interviews. I don't know that I necessarily contributed a lot of those interviews, but I went along and we did quite a few interviews and different things around Liverpool as well. A lot of that we didn't get necessarily connections with Adelaide, but it was really good for background. So, yeah, went to lots of different cafes, interviewing different people, lots of tribute bands, listening to different songs. I wrote a poem for the book when I was, 13 or 14. So, yeah, a lot of it I think was probably moral support. But then I also went through at the end and did the final edits. I'm sure Dad did some edits of his own, but I definitely went through and did editing and suggestions and that kind of thing at the end as well.
I'm just looking at how many pages there are in the book, and it's like 234. And, I mean, as I said, had you not told me that's Klaas Voorman, I'd never have known that he designed that.
We have to preface it with that because it's so bizarre. If you don't say that it's Klaas Voorman, people just think it's weird. Tell them that it's Klaas and they think it's classic.
Yeah.
They think it's brilliant after you say that.
Well, yeah, but that's what I'm saying. That's world class. It's getting the cover. That's what gets Phil Lennon to doing the cover for you.
It's still bizarre to me to think Klaas Voorman did the cover, you know. And I was in Liverpool for Beatles Week a while ago, and Tony Sheridan was one of the acts performing, and I met him afterwards, and I gave him a copy of the book, and he loved the cover. But he said he was a funny guy, and I assume he was joking, but he was saying to people, look at this guy. He's got a kangaroo on the cover with Beatles coming out of the pouch. This guy's crazy. As I say, I think he was joking.
But you know what? I'm just saying, Klaas Voorman, of course you know, designed the Revolver album with the heads.
Yeah.
And then he also helped with the anthology series, right? So what I'm saying is, I mean, this is like... And you not told me this, I would not know that. And I can tell you now, today, the world knows now this is Klaas Voorman. As soon as this interview is over, every Beatle group in the world will be looking at this. And I want to ask you now, how do they actually buy the book? Because this is like a collector's item. So what's the best way to buy the book, Michael?
Yeah, thanks, Plastic. So probably to email me is the best. Best way, msavas, SAVVAS at hotmail.com. And I'll sort it out. It's funny because we did the book 10 years ago. There's still some interest. Even a couple of weeks ago, some guy from New York contacted me and wanted a copy sent over. It's nice. Maybe because of lockdowns and whatever people are reading, I don't know, but it seems to be still some interest in the book, which is really cool.
If you had to tell me one part of the book, each of you, not too long, what is the most fascinating part of the book for you, Olivia?
The most fascinating part of the book. That's a tough one. I think for me, a lot of the stories that came out from the young kids skipping school to go and see the Beatles, I found really interesting because before that I didn't really know about that side of it. So many people that we spoke to told us that they skipped school and got caught out in their uniform, or even my Nana who went to go and see them. Her school, I know they had special restrictions on the day and, you know, a letter sent out to kids saying, on the day the Beatles come, all the girls have to be in school and that kind of thing. And she went out anyway. So just kind of hearing and not really understanding just how intense it was for the young people, because I couldn't compare it to anything today. I don't think there was anything I cared about that much at 16 that I would skip school and cry in the street. So for me, it's a really interesting time of history to think back on and kind of imagine how it took over lots of different age groups, but particularly the kids at school.
Unbelievable. Michael, what about you?
Well, I mean, to me, I'd say one of the most interesting things is what May Pang, John Lennon's girlfriend, had to say. We interviewed her through Skype as part of our research. and she did the foreword to the book as well. And she was talking about how John asked her in the 70s to pay her a visit. And he said, look, you've got to listen to this song. It's just unbelievable. And it's our song. It reminds me of us. And the song was Reminiscing by Little River Band. So this is an Adelaide band. And here we have in New York, John Lennon, you know, really moved by this song. And so she was saying that, you know, now whenever she hears Reminiscing, she knows John's around. And she tells the story, I won't give it all away, but she tells the story how she had all these kind of signs that John was around. And I believe that because I felt these kind of presences during the book as well, you know, without getting to whatever. So yeah, and as I won't spoil the story, but it's interesting to see how she understood John was around, and it's connected to that Adelaide band, Little River Band, and Reminiscing.
All I can say is it's been a riveting interview. To all the world, don't wait. Get the book. I hope there's a big supply of these books around, Michael.
I've got a big garage.
We use them as okay,
I'm stuff. Glad. Don't wait, because it's like when they're gone, they're gone. Is that right?
Yeah, pretty much. And,
would that be right? So I'm lucky.
Yeah, exactly.
I got the book, but not only did I get the book, you know what happened? I've got it signed. You can't see it. I knew that's going to happen, right? Because of my background. You can't see it, but it's signed by Olivia, signed by Michael the Plastic EP, and that's gone straight into my library as one of the VIP books. Look at that. You can't beat it.
Look at that. Thanks. Thanks so much, Plastic, for putting us on your show and showing interest in this book. And it's brought all the magic of the book back to me and the magic of sharing the book with my daughter and doing the book with her. And, you know, I really appreciate your support. And people should check out your songs as well. They're really catchy songs.
All I can say is, hey, Bananas, we think you're groovy. And I'll tell you what. One of the most grooviest families I've ever met, and Plastic EP clones are you guys, and I've thoroughly enjoyed the interview from the start to the end, and my ears have just opened up with things that I didn't know. This book is gold, world-class written book. I can tell you that now. Don't wait, buy the book, because when it's gone, Michael, it's gone, isn't it? When supplies go, you won't be reprinting it, will you?
No, exactly.
Okay, so I'm not going to ask you how many copies are left. They can figure it out. So if you miss out on this fabulous book that's got the cover by Klaus Vollmann, and it's got, as we said, the foreword by?
May Pang.
How do you beat that? This is a seller. Go ahead and get the book. All right, so from Plastic EP fantastic. And...
from Olivia.
And Michael X.
There you go.
Michael X.
I forget to see ya.